Greetings, fellow Earthlings! Welcome to this tiny garage.
So what is the secret that nobody tells you about working on a Porsche? Well, if you remember last week, in order to get the engine out of the bottom of the back of this car, you have to take apart a whole bunch of stuff on the back, on the bottom of this car, which means you have to spend a lot of time underneath the car doing things like this and unnatural things like that. And so I wasn't ready for it, I'll be honest with you. I'm just saying, do some stretches or something. Like, if you're a young person, you young folk out there, ignore everything I'm saying. This makes no sense. But for everyone else, I'm just saying, be prepared. Now, if you're not sure what I'm talking about, let this be a warning to you. Anyway, that is painful to watch. Let's move on to the car. And when I was looking around to take off the exhaust, I noticed a little extra damage here to the rear engine carrier. I looked them up. They're not particularly expensive. As long as the rebuild goes well, I probably will replace that. Now, do you remember this guy? Do you remember how calm, professional, and alive he looks? Now, remember this guy? Do you remember how dead he still looks? I was concerned I was going to look like that guy. Now, in my effort to imitate the professionals, here is a hydraulic table from Harbour Freight, of course. It's supposed to support up to 1,000 pounds, and that should be enough. Okay, so you don't have to take the exhaust off in order to take the engine out. But I do want to get the exhaust off because when it's attached to the car, it's much easier to wrench on it. Now, I use those yellow straps to attach it to the bumper because I don't want it flying off the end of the car when I get the bolts undone and clanging on the ground. Underneath the car, it's all 13 millimeters, as you might expect. Porsche seems to love their 13 mils. You don't need to use that ridiculously long extension, but it kind of made it easier. Once they were loosened, I went around with the electric socket wrench, and that made light work of getting them out. Now, here was a thing. I'd forgotten a step. If you go back to engine removal part 1, step 12, the oxygen sensors, there's actually two sets of two clips. And so I missed that set in the passenger side rear corner. So you do have to disconnect those. Then what I'm doing is passing those oxygen sensor cables through so that the oxygen sensors can leave with the exhaust. And then by undoing those yellow straps, I was able to lower that exhaust onto the hydraulic table and away from the car. Then to disconnect the exhaust, there's this one bracket and it's a 13 millimeter. If you undo that, they'll come apart. Now that is it. With the help of this old floor mat and this piece of wood, we have to support the engine and transmission assembly because the next bolts we're taking off are getting towards the end. Exciting stuff. If you're enjoying these videos and you'd like me to make more, the best way to tell me is to click that subscribe button. First up here is transmission support. Either side of the transmission in the very front, this bracket bolts onto the body of the car. And so that was a 15 millimeter. I thought I was good with just whacking it with a hammer, but no, I had to employ a new technique. I have this large 1¼-inch wrench in the garage. I don't know where it came from. I don't know why I have it, but I did find a use for it
This is a better way of seeing what I'm up to here. I put it over the other wrench, the 15 mil, and then you use its tremendous leverage to open that bolt up, which is very handy. I'm not sure how you're supposed to do that otherwise. A breaker bar, I guess, but I don't have a breaker bar that big. Then with the hammer, I was able to continue moving that bolt a little bit. Then I had the realization that actually the center of that nut and bolt combination has a 7mm that you have to hold. It was frustrating, as you can imagine. Here is a successful version of that. So holding that middle one with a 7mm box wrench and then the 15mm ratchet on the outside, and I got that off on both sides. Then that transmission support is attached to the transmission brace sheet metal, and that's these four 15mm nuts on either side there. Again, using that ridiculous extension sort of helped, you know. And then for the main grunt work, bringing in that electric socket wrench. The far side there, again, not really that big of a problem once you kind of got the angle right to get some oomph on it. That deep socket, I don't know how good an idea that was. You see, I kind of rounded off that nut a little bit there. It ended up working, but not the best idea, maybe. So at that point, you're supposed to be able to get the transmission loose from the car. So I lowered things a little, and it's true. You can get everything pretty loose right there.
Ian Falcon, you are my professional inspiration. Thank you.
Next up is the rear engine carrier. At the very back of the engine in the corners, there's these two 18mm that hold the carrier into the engine bay. Had to use that new technique again with that ridiculously cartoonishly large wrench. Now, according to the book, that's it. You're done. You can just lower the engine. I didn't believe myself, and so I just lowered things gingerly and got my flashlight and ran around the place to sort of seeing what I'd missed. So what came up there is that large coolant hose kind of got stuck between the engine and the car, something that could have been prevented by just sort of pushing it up before letting the engine come down. So here's something. Of the coolant hoses in the rear left-hand side of the engine, you need to undo every single one of them. There's one big one and two small ones. So don't dilly-dally. Do that as soon as you're doing all the coolant hoses right back near the beginning of the removal process. Once I got the engine lowered a bit, it seemed the right time to go back to the power steering lines. And yes, found it difficult to understand why it was so difficult to get the one done before. With all this space, it really is an easy job. It's important to mention that it's the back part of these connectors that rotates. The front part you're holding and the back part is going to move. Once you break them free, they come off very easily. And I found it easy to put some Ziploc bags on them just to stop any leakage.
Nate Mallory, thanks for watching.
Next up, I found that this hose that goes onto the expansion tank that actually comes from the oil cooler on the other side of the engine. Nobody mentioned that one, but that does actually have to come off as well. Oh dear, did you ever have that sinking feeling? You notice how the engine is not really ready to move back. But as we look at the transmission, it's not really ready to come down. There's not enough space. The scissor lift is in the way. My decision here may be a little polarizing for some of you. I decided just to cut it off. It seems very strong already. And I figured of the four subframes, if you imagine this is like a subframe, it could probably do with losing one, couldn't it? Anyway, I got my saws all going and the blade got stuck. I figured just because of the gap and everything moving as I'm cutting away the metal, which is not really confidence inspiring, I decided to just move around to the other side and try to chop as much of that as I could. As it got towards the end, that one started bucking as well. I decided maybe a longer blade would help, but no, that started getting stuck. By that time, I realized I had actually cut quite a lot, so I figured brute force might work. And it turns out brute force was just right. So there we go, satisfying moment there. Got to clean that up and back at it. And yes, it seems like that might work. So just lowering it again gingerly, trying to be patient. Here's another one that didn't get mentioned. There's a little zip tie on the passenger side of the engine bay that holds on to the cables for those two round connectors that are the engine wiring harness. So they need to leave with the engine and they can't unless you cut that zip tie. Another one that wasn't mentioned anywhere is these little coolant clips. We're on the passenger side of the car here, right there underneath the drive axles, a little plastic clip. It undoes from the top and that allows these two coolant hoses that run to the radiators in the front of the car to come away with the engine. Okay, back again, lowering it ever so slowly, seeing what else I might have missed. And I came to the realization that, oh dear.
Edward Stasek. Hi.
Transmission support brace. Now, if you don't have a scissor lift like this, if you're on axle stands or on a two-post lift, you probably don't have to take this thing off. But I had to. It wasn't going to make it out otherwise. It was really much easier than it looks. Just a 15mm that I'm holding on the far side and then using that 15mm electric socket wrench to get them undone. And then those two pieces of sheet metal came off together and left a bit of space, hopefully. So now lowering it that a little bit more, looking around again. I don't trust anything anymore because a number of these things just weren't mentioned in the book or in forums or anything. So it looks like I'm home free here. Backing it up, I'm like, oh my gosh, getting excited. But no, crankcase breather hose. So that connects right here to the coolant hoses in the front. I don't know why. I suspect that is a future diagram waiting to happen. But you have to undo that. Oh my gosh. Yeah, there you go. I can't believe it. Finally got this lump out of the car. Not quite sure what to do with it now, but that is definitely a big step completed. Thank you very much, everybody, for helping me get this bit done. Thought we'd take a moment to have a look around. That's the backup light switch that almost gave me a hernia. There's the gear shift lever that just rotates around that one central pivot. There's the oil cooler that connects up to the evaporation tank on the other side of the engine. That was what we had to undo for step 41. Here's the passenger side of the engine. That's bank 2 from left to right, cylinders 4, 5, and 6. That yellow pipe at the top is the fuel rail that provides fuel to the cylinders on that side. There's our own personal Exxon Valdez oil slick next to cylinder four right there. Those are the engine wiring harness connectors we spoke about that we had to disconnect for step 42. That bullhorn shaped piece of metal is the rear engine carrier that we may have to replace because of the slight damage. Coming over onto the driver's side right now, this is the cylinder head of bank one. From right to left, cylinders one, two, and three. Right there is the crankcase breather that the hose in step 45 was connected to. That again is a mystery device. This area above the drive axle on the driver's side is where the clutch slave cylinder was located. Then not much else to report on this side of the transmission. As we look up here, we can see it's kind of fun to look on inside here. It reminds me of some spaceship that's come back from orbit. And we can see inside quite a lot of space left. All the more that this car reminds me of a little go-kart with a big engine stuck in the back. Next, I went around the engine and took detailed photographs of as much as I could, just so I'd know what everything looked like before I had a chance to mess it up. And there's our little baby.
Unfortunately, that's all we have time for this week. Thank you very much for watching. Till next time.
Renko Kodam, you rock!
There we go.
All right.